Good morning and welcome everybody to this session on testing innovative social impact measurement in complex contexts. Thank you for all of you who are joining us. We started a few minutes late because I know there are other sessions, and even in this virtual environment, there is the syndrome of having to rush from one session to the next. But thank you very much, everyone, for joining us. My name is Mary Martin. I'm Senior Policy Fellow at the London School of Economics, LSE Ideas, and I'm the Director of the UN Business and Human Security Initiative at LSE Ideas, which has been working to develop some of the proposals that you're going to hear about today. In our session, we're going to be presenting a new methodology that applies the twin concepts of human security and positive peace in order to measure corporate impacts in complex contexts, complex and fragile conflict-affected settings, through focusing on how companies engage with local communities. This work is part of a two-year program that we've been conducting with the UN, called the UN Business and Human Security Initiative. And as part of that program, we've developed a governance model called Human Security Business Partnerships, precisely to address the challenges, the local governance challenges, and the relationship between companies, investors, and local communities and other local stakeholders on the ground. So what you're going to hear today is part of that program, which is ongoing with the United Nations. And in subsequent steps, what we're hoping to do is to refine the approach that you'll hear about today and initiate more human security business partnerships in different settings on the ground. We're already working in Colombia. We've done some work in Mexico, and we've done some work in Liberia. But obviously there are plenty of different sectoral and geographic contexts in which the sometimes problematic, challenging relationship between the private sector and local communities against a background of the need to create sustainable impacts can occur. So the point of this session from our perspective is to invite you to help us refine our methodology, examine it, explore some of the obstacles and the opportunities that exist for measuring social impact. I'm delighted to have four speakers to present and respond to our approach. But at the same time, we also want all of you to participate. So please pose questions and comment. You can do that during the presentations in the first part of this session if you use the chat function at the bottom of your screen. And then after about 30 minutes, what we'll do is we'll turn over to a proper audience debate for your questions and further comments. We also have an online poll, just a few questions which will pop up throughout this session, and you can answer them directly on screen. There'll be about a sort of 30-second pause to allow you to look at the question and think about your answer. So I think there are three questions in total, and we hope to share the results with you at the end. So we can start with, before we go to the speakers, start with the first question, which you should see on your screens now. Pretty straightforward, just so that we can get an idea of which sector and perspective you're representing. So please just take a few seconds, tick one of the boxes, and then we can move on to the presentation itself. Okay. So first, let me introduce our first two speakers, and you can see from the poll we have a kind of instant snapshot of the results. So let me turn to our first two speakers, who will present our approach. Mark van Dorp is the founder of Bureau van Dorp, has spent a lot of time consulting and working with companies specializing in how to create responsible business in fragile and conflict-affected settings. Marcel Schmitz is the CEO of FCS Impact and also a director of the Institute for Economics and Peace in the Netherlands. And IEP is a partner with LSE Ideas on our UN Business and Human Security Initiative. So welcome, Mark and Marcel, and the floor is yours to present.
Thank you very much, Mary. Let me just start off by sketching out the problem that we identified when we were developing our paper. So there are four main issues we found. The first one is that, as you probably all know, businesses are facing growing public expectations and a demand from investors to contribute in a positive way to the so-called ESG issues, environmental, social, and governance issues, as well as to the SDGs, of course. And this is, something that that is increasingly also not just a bonus, but something that is really required by investors or shareholders to make sure that companies are doing good and not just making a profit. So secondly, what we see is that, most companies, especially the bigger ones, are facing greater legal accountability, which also means that they have to be much better at tracking their ESG impacts and reporting on them. And this includes, for instance, the increased number of lawsuits against companies, but also the trend that there's more let's say binding regulations for disclosing human rights due diligence and acting upon it. One example of how fast this is moving is that we know that in several countries there is already binding legal measures to for improved due diligence, human rights due diligence, that is. And in the Netherlands, there's a law being prepared to that sense. And recently, a very interesting initiative has taken off, which is the Initiative for Sustainable and Responsible Business Conduct that is actively trying to advocate for this binding regulations. And, this is not only NGOs doing this, but a lot of businesses asking for this themselves because they want to have a level playing field. And they want, everyone to be facing the same mandatory requirements in this field. So the third problem that we, this is more directly related to fragile and conflict-affected settings, which was actually where we're in our paper, we are zooming in on these settings. Basically, because what we see there is that companies, in addition to, like, let's say, the normal ESG issues, they're struggling to address the complex and dynamic reality on the ground. And that includes, local conflicts between different ethnic groups or between government and rebel groups. High levels of insecurity, but also the lack of governance itself, which often means that companies have to take on a greater responsibility, in terms of making sure that that they're not doing any harm. And another question, apart from the responsibility, is that they often have a problem in determining what is material and what is, what might be actually a negative impact, but not affecting the company in a material sense, financially material. So finally, what we found is that a lot of companies, they try to improve their measurement of impacts, but this is mostly related to environmental impacts and not so much on social impacts. And they also tend to work towards a standard that aims to minimize risks and minimize their negative impacts. So what is called the do no harm approach. And what we think would be, you know, like very important is to get to a methodology that can actually measure the positive impacts of companies. And to show that when you are, you know, paying more attention to the positive impacts in terms of human security and positive peace, this is also rewarding financially. And this is something that I think, you know, there's a lot of attention for these social impacts also as a result of COVID-19 pandemic. So we think this is very timely to look at ways to improve this. So finally, before handing over to Marcel, I would like to just, I want you to take a look at this map, which is the Fragile States Index, which is published every year by the Fund for Peace, based on a large number of indicators, you know, which is basically saying which countries are very difficult to operate in, because of the fragile situation, the lack of governance, as I said, levels of conflict and violence. And what you see is that, you know, you could say from yellow up to red, these countries are more or less fragile. So that's most of the world, actually. And this map was, if I'm correct, done before the COVID-19 pandemic started. So it's probably gotten even worse. But I think what we can learn from this is that many companies, whether they like it or not, are faced with fragile and conflict-affected settings and have to find a way around it. So that's why we thought it would be a good idea to look at an impact measurement methodology. And this is what Marcel is going to talk about now. Marcel, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mark. Hello, everyone. Yeah, the point that Mark was making about the fragility of so many countries in the world also means that so many of the goods we buy and rely on today are connected to these fragile societies. In our research, we point out that risks in those particular fragile environments carry a particular meaning. Many sustainability risks, such as climate change, human rights, diversity, health, or safety, have close relations to conflict and security in those environments. And those tend to be overlooked and can easily lead to negative impact on stability in general and on local people's security in particular. Now, although there are some companies that still like to believe that sustainabilities are not real financial risks and therefore not financially material, there is, however, a general consensus that an issue can be material, can be relevant to the company, regardless of whether it's financial or non-financial. Now, our research is based on the notion that the SDGs are material for companies in fragile and conflict-affected settings, which then should be reflected in long-term performance indicators, in our view. So the question is, what are then the SDGs that are material to the business activity in fragile and conflict-affected settings? To identify those, we propose that a material analysis takes place from the ground up in order to identify which ESG issues are relevant for company and community, and also to inform the global standards that are applied today. So for instance, a global standard on water as a shared resource that requires companies to disclose water-related impact would greatly benefit from a bottom-up analysis based on the water needs of people and the related security risks to health, livelihood, etc. So such a localized material analysis can bring to the surface what issues have an impact on the community, and that will also then clarify the corporate responsibility and meet expectations by investors, which can then eventually lead to benefits for both communities and companies together. Now, the second point that we're making is that by using human security as an approach, which essentially connects security, fragility, and human rights, and also development, by using that approach in a local material analysis, the risks to companies and communities that are spread over multiple dimensions, such as economic risks, environmental risks, food security risk, but also political risk, can be more easily identified, and that will also help to inform the KPIs of companies. Now, this approach offers a way to pull E, S, and G issues together, and so not miss important connections between them, which is frequently the case, I'm afraid. So for instance, climate issues that cause droughts in a certain area that affects people's livelihood are also more likely to trigger further competition over resources in fragile settings, where often pre-existing divisions and deep-rooted inequalities between groups are present. Now, those type of relationships between risks can offer indications of key thresholds to show when these risks become a threat to people's personal or group security. So by bringing these together, the human elements of security, rights, and development, we hope to present a simple methodology for localization of the SDGs to show which SDGs are most relevant and give guidance on how actions on them can be both risk responsive and generate positive impact. Now you'll see here in this slide, this is a visualization of various dimensions of human security and the risk within those dimensions. Now, the only point I'd like to make here is rather than select SDGs based on an alignment with the core business that is what is the case today, essentially, like an energy company may choose to report on SDG 7, the renewable energy goal, we propose that local risks faced by people form the starting point for possible SDG contributions. So if such an approach is applied by companies, it actually considers the interconnectedness between these dimensions and show how E, G, and G are linked and can be prioritized. So in the example of renewable energy, that we know that that also impacts poverty, impacts food security, health, and gender equality. So all of a sudden, SDG contributions become much more tangible and multiple, and that's the point we're trying to make here. Now, the next point on the next slide is that human security and positive peace work very well together for measuring social impact by business. Both concepts, previous point of the slide, both concepts acknowledge the interconnectivity between human rights, security, and development. Positive peace is a concept that measures the factors that create and sustain peace in a society, or also basically the ability to absorb shocks and recover from them more easily. So what we're saying is that essentially increasing levels of positive, so-called positive peace in a society offers more human security guarantees for people. So that also means that it can be, positive peace serves as a good measure for a society's or a community's resilience against a threat or a shock that is faced by people. And because it gets a bit technical here, but because of its systems approach, it can be applied at different levels, national level and local levels in the same way. Now, the thing is that both positive peace and ESG, actually, if you look at the indicators and look at the relationship between, they highly correlate, which makes positive peace as an instrument very suitable to assess and measure the capacity to deal with risks faced by both people and companies. Now, the last point concerns the human security partnerships that are valuable for measuring that social impact, which we've been talking about. Now, our research shows that companies require much more collaborative solutions if they wish to track and measure their real impact on the ground. And we think that can be established by much more more structured community engagement process, which is really missing today. So the Human Security Business Partnership Framework is an example of such an engagement process between companies, communities, and other stakeholders. It offers really a guidance model comprising principles such as local, inclusive, and transparent, and a set of shared processes and tools that can ground and direct interventions. Now, this, my last point is that especially in places where structured data is lacking, consultations and data collections by local parties will be helpful to establish these human security risks. Now, such a partnership can be considered an essential, what I call a collaborative governance mechanism to determine ESG factors by company, agree on impact indicators together, and validate the social impact through this mechanism in a much more collaborative way. So this concludes our presentation at this moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark and Marcel, for a very succinct presentation of what is a very, I think, rich and interesting paper, which, as they said at the outset, goes to the heart of some of the complexities and the dynamic qualities of the particular settings, the fragile settings that we focused on, which are such a challenge to investors and companies. If you would like to, and we hope we do, read more in depth about the proposal, and indeed the Human Security Business Partnership Framework that it rests on, we'll be posting a link in the chat box, which will take you to the paper itself. Before I turn to our next two speakers to respond to what they've heard from Mark and Marcel, we have another poll question for you to answer in the audience. And it deals with the challenge part of our presentation. So what's the most pressing issue you think that requires more attention when doing business in these fragile and conflict-affected settings? So a few different multiple choice options there, if you could click on one of them, and then we will move on. Okay, I think that might stay up. Here we are, we've got the results from that particular question. But let me move now to our next two speakers. I have great pleasure in introducing Lara Vesemius-Schiebrach as our first respondent. Lara has extensive experience in sustainability and impact as an investment banker, and then head of investments at the Cordaid Foundation until 2018. She's currently managing director of the Netherlands Advisory Board on Impact Investing. Lara, a warm welcome to you. Thank you for joining us, and tell us your thoughts on today's topic of impact in fragile and conflict zones.
Thank you very much, Mary, and congratulations, Marcel, and Mark for this beginning of presentation. I think it's really relevant, and I want to say that I'm very honored to be invited to give a first reaction to that. Maybe just three comments I would like to make based on what you said earlier this morning. First of all, a general remark that in designing tools, it's very important to make them easy to use, practicable. And I would like to make a reference to the IFC ESG assessment standards, which I think are quite broadly used in developing countries and more specifically in fragile and conflict affected states. And I think you were talking about the fact that corporates have not only to tick the box of doing no harm, but also starting to measure the impact. And I think a good common denominator can be that ESG assessment tool of the IFC. It's quite broadly used also by a lot of development finance organizations and impact funds around the world. You mentioned something else in your presentation, the accountability aspect, and that really very much resonates with my own experience. Lawsuits are, of course, a risk. Regulation is very important. And I think there I would like to make reference to another initiative from the Global Steering Group on Impact Investment, which is a follower of the Task Force on Impact Investment from the G8. The Netherlands Advisory Board on Impact Investing, of which I'm a part of, is the national chapter in the Netherlands of that global group. And the GSG is now working on an initiative on impact-weighted accounts. They do that together with Harvard Business School, so academics are also involved there. And what that initiative would like to do is actually measure the impact in a broader sense, just the positive impact as much as the negative one, the footprint, you would say, and formulate it in a financial result. And interestingly, you would realize that a lot of corporations that are nowadays profitable would actually end up being not profitable if you applied that new standard, a bit like an IFRS taking into account the impact as well. So I very much believe that probably led by Europe, who's very advanced, a lot of corporations will have in the future to be more accountable and maybe hopefully adopt that kind of impact weighted initiative. And then, last comment, we talk a lot about corporates, and I think, of course, they lead by example, but they are by no means all. If you look at the composition of the economic activity, especially in fragile and conflict-affected states, I think small and medium enterprises and micro-enterprises represent anywhere between 60 and 70% of the economic activities, which is most jobs. So I would emphasize, don't forget them. And since we don't have any direct influence or control on how ESG is dealt with for these small organizations, one very good proxy is and the way these organizations get access to finance. So financial institutions can be a good a way of making sure that these SMEs have the right respect for social or environmental aspects. So that's it on my side.
Thank you very much, Lara. Some very good points there to bear in mind. I think the point about practicality is really important. I think when we were doing the initial engagement for research on this paper, we had a round table in the Netherlands, and one got the sense very much that companies obviously are faced with a blizzard of different kind of standards, tools, guidance, and so on. So in order to cut through that kind of proliferation of different models, I think the focus has to be on something that's very practical, very relatively easy and straightforward to implement. Our final speaker is Gert Scheuter. Gert is senior sustainability expert at the Palladium Group, which is a global consultancy working with companies across all sectors. They mobilize private capital for social issues, balancing that with a financial return for investors. So very much aware of the kinds of challenges that investors face. Gert, thank you for joining us today. Please give us your response to both the challenge and the solutions that perhaps we've heard so far. Over to you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Mary. Yeah, I think for me as a consultant working with companies, with private companies and public companies, I think dealing with these concepts of human security and positive peace, translating that to into an approach is relatively new. They sound to me as a new language, and I need to wrap my head around it, I think, a little bit more. And indeed, we would need a deeper understanding of the approach in terms of practical real life settings and see how that works. And speaking for my work and the context in which I work, mainly in developing countries, most of the ideas and conversations I'm having also with colleagues circle around ESG-based impact measurement and monitoring, often indeed impact investing related. I actually want to share three examples in which I'm explaining what I do, and then maybe to see how this concept could help. First, that earlier this year, I worked with a cement company in Nigeria, and I developed an ESG roadmap for that organization. And we integrated a materiality assessment into the process, and that was very important, but also very difficult process. And in hindsight, I think that it would have maybe be good to have these human security and positive peace approach available, because it could have been helpful there to create specifically the, let's say, the activity around the materiality assessment on ESG issues with that company. Another example, at the moment, I'm working with the Social Performance Task Force to review a set of universal standards for social performance management for microfinance institutions. And that, of course, like Laura already said, is a sector that works with vulnerable poor clients in remote areas. And they are working very hard to put the clients in the middle, understanding, of course, their vulnerability. And I'm working with the Social Performance Task Force to integrate a new dimension, an additional dimension to that standards, focusing on green finance. And for them, for that sector, it's quite revolution to have green as an element of their social performance standards. And I'm working with them a long time. And 10 years ago, we asked microfinance institutions repeatedly in various international conferences and surveys about their interest in environmental management. And to be honest, we got very negative feedback, pushback, because the microfinance institutions then said, we are dealing with the poorest of the poor, and green banking we see as a luxury. We don't understand it, and it would be, for in our idea, very cynical to focus on environmental issues if our clients are starving. So that was then, and now these insights have shifted in the past period. And because climate change, mainly, I interviewed a number of microfinance institutions in Africa last year for IFAD, and we had 32 face-to-face conversations with managers of MFIs, and all of them, or one not, but over 90% of them said that, yes, our clients are affected by climate change and it harms their family income. And we see as an MFI that these effects are not just bad for our clients, but also for us. Our portfolio quality is under pressure because of that. So we see a sector with public, private and blended capital investment struggling to find solutions for more resiliency, and a way to get it integrated into their core business is in a meaningful way. That's their difficulty. So I think that in my work, I'm exploring how human security model can help us with that as well. And maybe one final third example, that I'm working now with the Challenge Fund for Youth Employment. This is a Ministry of Foreign Affairs in the Netherlands project focused on creating jobs for youth in Northern and Central Africa and Middle East. And I'm helping in that project to also integrate a broader ESG approach there. And we're looking at using the human security model there as well. So I think this is a very helpful conversation, and it's an exciting conversation as well. And I hope that these practical examples are maybe helpful in the conversation. So I look forward to the rest of the discussion. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Gert. Yes, really good to have actual examples in the field to throw up some of the and highlight some of the very practical difficulties that arise. And I think your point about, you know, materiality, when you were talking about the environment, not introducing kind of green issues when people are starving, I think one of the things that we felt that particularly in fragile settings, I think something that Mark referred to at the outset, because they tend to be quite dynamic, conditions change all the time. That's also true of what's material, isn't it? And making that kind of very delicate connection between what is material on the ground, but maybe what a company at headquarters level has in mind in terms of its key performance indicators, its SDG commitments, its other ESG obligations, and finding that sort of that right connection is very much behind what we hoped to do with this approach. And just finally, if I say something about the you mentioned human security and as a new language, I think in all these discussions, it is partly about finding a new way to articulate a problem that is, you know, has suddenly, as it were, increasingly materialized itself. And I think probably as the kind of human security person on this team, the idea of human security, I've always felt, has resonance in some of these settings, because it can be a way of, if you like, evening out the very divergent kind of mindsets and interests between companies, investors on the one hand, and local stakeholders, particularly local communities. And if one can develop this kind of idea of human security as a language for coming to shared agendas and a shared identification of the challenge and how it should be done, and therefore how you measure impact, I think is a huge part of the puzzle to be unpacked. So thank you very much from all four of you for kind of setting us up for the final part of our session, which is to allow you in the audience to ask some questions, to challenge us, and so on. We have our final poll question, which goes to the heart of the problem of today's session, if you like. How beneficial do you think this approach is for assessing environmental, social, and governance risks in fragile states and settings? And again, it's rather sort of broad brush, multiple choice, but if you could tick on one of those, even if it does not apply, but hopefully you can find one of the others. And as I say, we invite you to find out more by going to the paper itself. Okay, so moving on to the final part. If you can use this is where the technicals get possibly quite challenging, certainly for me the whole time. In the chat function, you can put up any questions or comments. In theory, if you go to the participant button as well, you should be able to raise your hand and I can invite you to ask your question in person. That's the bit I'm not sure we'll work on this functionality, but we'll give it a go. But if that doesn't work, please post comments or questions to all our panelists in the chat box so that we can continue the debate. Maybe I will start off with a question back to Marcel and Mark, which is, I know one thing that came up in our initial round table was this question of responsibility. And we've talked a bit about materiality, how this this process that we propose sets up a dialogue in order to help identify what is materially local, locally material. But I know another sort of concept that was raised right at the outset was by companies in the sense of their concern that they're being asked to take on in a very practical as well as ethical sense, much more and more, you know, that the measurement exercise, the measurement process becomes more complicated. Where does their responsibility start and end? And I wonder if Mark or Marcel, you wanted to just comment on how you see this process is also helping to define the kind of the extent, the scope of the process and the scope of corporate responsibility in these settings.
Are you then referring to the reporting aspects? Did I understand that correctly?
Yes, I think one of the things that struck me in our original discussions was that companies feel a bit sort of weighed down by all this, that A, it becomes very complicated in a practical sense. They're being asked to report on more and more. But also, how do they understand not just what's material risk, but what, you know, the extent of their responsibility in terms of impacts should be? And I just wondered if you could comment on how this process helps, if you like, to define and identify that kind of general responsibility, both for reporting, but in, you know, how they behave and engage and interact with local communities.
Yeah, I guess the starting point is that at the moment there is just such a lack of clarity on what the actual impact is, and that's where it all starts. I mean, companies can make all kinds of claims, and they do at certain levels. And what we're trying to show here is that, you know, things are, first of all, issues are much more connected than one can imagine. So having a positive effect on environment doesn't necessarily, you know, could also easily translate to more human rights, negative human rights impacts. On the other hand, there's plenty of examples like that. But so the point is first to understand that actual impact. And what we're trying to do here is just if you take a much more local approach and try to figure that out from the outset, then that will eventually help in, you know, sort of guide you along the process in terms of what do you think your responsibility is then if you see those impacts, if you understand them better, you know, they can offer more of a guidance. And in the end, it's about the company's ambition. It's about its, you know, it depends on the level of influence, the leverage that they may have over the ability, to do something about it. And so some companies may say, oh yeah, this is not really for us. And others will say, well, we'll take it on. First is, I think that is to get this understanding. And once you have that, what we try to show with this process that it can be easily tied to existing ways you're at the moment already, you know, that they're already doing risk management. Why not include more of these community interconnected risk while you're doing your risk management? So while you're figuring that out, you can already reporting on it. You can do this easily along the way, and it leads you to much better and more genuine reporting what is happening on SDGs, for instance. And that's what we're trying to show as well. You don't need, you don't need all these different, you know, you're reporting on human rights guidelines, you're reporting on SDGs, you're reporting on your risk management. You can actually integrate them if you just have a better understanding how these things are connected.
I think you. I think it. You know, the connections are really important to highlight, and just. I mean, that's very much where we felt the positive peace and the human security approach work together, as Marcel had highlighted before. That is to somehow give some clarity and put some real flesh on where the important interconnections are, and try and take a more kind of holistic view. Geert, can I perhaps ask you, as you're on very much on the front line of these things and advising, what do you feel companies see as, I mean, what troubles them most? What are you being asked to advise on in particular at the moment? What's the what are the chief concerns in a both practical and a kind of ethical sense, perhaps?
Let's say the capacity, the internal in-company capacity, both at the management level and at execution level. So as a consultant, I'm asked to assist and help companies who are convinced, if you want, that they should do more, or they should develop an environmental and social approach, or they should do something about sustainability in their core business. What I find most is that many organizations say, well, this is totally unknown territory for us, so help us do that. And then what I find, what is the most difficult thing in that is to, not so much to convince the leaders of an organization, because most of, you know, in that situation, most of the top leaders, they understand or they want it, but then how to get it internalized and operationalized further down in the organization. And that often, you know, you need to be very, I can't find the proper English word for it, but it needs time, let's say. So the challenge is I would say the main practical challenge to overcome, to make sure that within an organization things are happening.
Yeah. No, I think that certainly resonates very much. I think when we've done sort of work and roundtables with companies before, quite often it comes down to the weakest link. You know, you can have a strategy, you can have a kind of policy in place, but whether it succeeds or whether it fails, they were, you know, according to what companies tend to tell us, it's down to whether the man or woman at the grassroots kind of gets it and understands it and has the capacity to implement it. And then if they leave or move, then, you know, it's not sustained, right, that approach.
So just to add, I think that's true. And that is not just a matter of having it, you know, making sure that it lands in the organization, but also continuously managing that. And by the lack of that, I'm frustrated sometimes to see that, you know, my work in, for instance, setting up an environmental and social management system in a bank, because an investor wants to do business with the bank and the bank needs therefore an IFC compliant system or so. I support for a couple of months the organization, or a year, the organization, to get everything in place. And then once the system is in place in that organization and the IFC or an investor provides the funds, then suddenly, magically, the relevance of the whole system becomes much lower. So again, this is a matter of internalizing sustainability within an organization, really make an organization understand how a commercial how and focus on sustainability links to their commercial bottom line. And I think that's very difficult, and I sometimes don't know how to do it as well.
Laura, I mean, you mentioned the kind of standards work and word, and clearly there are a lot of those. Do you feel that we're in the right place with standard setting by different institutions, or do you feel that that kind of somehow overcomplicates it and again perhaps makes users, companies and investors just more more kind of bewildered really by, you know, what they have to do? And I think one of the things that struck us was, and certainly Marco and Marcel I think referred to it, is the need to kind of go beyond a minimalist approach, you know, just hitting a certain standard and perhaps doing a bit more positive. What's your feeling on the whole standards issue as helping us to get where we need to be on this?
I think Geert underlined it very well, and the problem of ownership of the issue within companies is a huge problem. So you need to tackle it by two ways, in my view, and it's how it's being done until now. It's A, it's engagement. So organizations like yours, like mine, like Geert's, investors, asset owners, regulators have to engage corporate or even engage further with regulation that they have to comply with certain standards. So that's there's also a sort of more a global realization that it has to be good for your business. So what Geert was saying, I recognize it very well. I've been a fund manager at Cordate, and if the financial institutions or the other organizations that you finance don't understand how important it is for them, for their business model, for doing business, that they actually have to implement this kind of measurement of their social or environmental performance, then the sooner you basically disburse the money or stop being an investor or a grant funder, then the sooner they stop implementing what you have asked them to do, and you're back to square one. So it needs to make sense for them, and that requests a lot of pedagogy, I think, with the beneficiaries of this kind of training or organizations that benefit from learning to measure their impact. But they really need to understand that it is good for their business. So if, for example, socially, if they learn to diversify the ethnies of their employees on the ground, they will have better relationship with the communities, which means they will be able to conduct their business in a more peaceful and efficient way. So they have to be conscious of these things. And that's why earlier today, the engagement with civil society, I think, was mentioned as 100% as the civil society or the local communities was mentioned as 100% as the most important aspect. Yes, that's true. But I also think that, the general realization of all the stakeholders in this business, starting with the providers of money, by the way, because, whenever you are financing an organization, you can put conditions, financial or non-financial. I think if you start with that, you already have a good ground for discussion, and then it will start to make sense for organizations to change their business model and integrate more of these aspects.
Yeah. Mark, do you just want to, we're running out of time, but go back to Mark. I think the important component in our approach is very much dialogue and kind of partnership. So a kind of sustained discussion, which hopefully gets away from what you're describing, Laura, that you have this kind of topical ad hoc, perhaps even negotiated exercise of measuring the impact to satisfy certain demands, but it's not a kind of part of a dialogue. Mark, do you just want to kind of reflect perhaps finally on the importance of that element in our proposals?
Right. No, that's actually something that that crossed my mind when I was listening to all of you, that the need for coalition building you know, companies are often, especially when it comes to very sensitive topics like human rights, corruption, you know, the involvement of security forces, they are very reluctant to deal with those issues on their own, right? And you know, and that's very well understood, you know, because they can easily get sometimes even you know, be kicked out of the country if they are too critical. So what I think is really crucial is that companies that they join forces and do this more as a collective approach. And just one example, I'm involved in an initiative for the Greater Mediterranean, which includes North Africa, Middle East, and Turkey, to see how businesses can actually learn from each other, build capacity, indeed, as Geert was saying, on how to deal with you know, basically creating more positive impacts in fragile settings. And as a, I think we're still at the beginning of that discussion, but there's a lot of scope to build on that. And a lot of willingness also within the business community. And I finally, I would like to say that I think the SME, we should not forget about the SMEs indeed, as Laura was rightly mentioning, simply because they are the ones who are, you know, who cannot leave a country that that becomes conflict affected. So they're often the ones who also much more sensitive about what is needed to solve conflict.
Yeah. Thank you, Mark. I don't know if anybody else heard, there seemed to be a bell in my audio stream, which probably is telling us that we're out of time. Thank you very much to all you four for your thoughts and reflections, and for all of those of you who are still attending as well, for following us. Please, you know, stay in touch with us. You've got the link to the paper. We welcome everybody's feedback, but very much welcome your time today. So thank you all, and have a good day, and enjoy the rest of ImpactFest. Bye-bye.